Originally, that's what drivers wore. Nothing more than cotton, just the same as an everyday shirt that you or I might wear to do gardening, and it really didn't provide a great deal of protection. Then along came a new material called Nomex. Nomex is actually a different material designed to provide good protection in the modern racing car, but you can see what happens after approximately 8 seconds. The Nomex actually begins to shrink and really turns crisp. This fabric is really quite hard, as well as being very hot. The last and the most successful breakthrough has been a brand new material called PBI. This material gives the ultimate protection as, very simply, it does not burn.
Well, we mentioned race cars, we got driver fashion, but we can't overstate the seriousness of that kind of fire protection, even this old-fashioned kind of fire protection. Plenty of racing still to come. Jaguars lead. We'll be back.
We are back live at Daytona with the driver that may run the anchor leg for the BMW number 18, Davy Jones. You've won already one time this season in the BMW. It's important for you to win here today.
It's very important. It's important for BMW and the whole motorsport program. But at the moment, my teammate John Andretti is doing a brilliant job out there. He's running third, and I hope to maintain that position and better it throughout the end of the race.
But there's a big question mark over this team's future next season, so obviously you may be able to sway the decision just a bit with a victory here.
I hope so. You know, it would be great for BMW, but it's particularly important for John Andretti and Davy Jones' future. We'd like to continue on in the motorsport in IMSA. And, you know, if BMW is a part of it, that's our priority.
All right, you can see the helmet on. He's ready for the driver change. The crew is ready. We're expecting John Andretti at any moment.
Okay, thank you, Gary. We'll keep an eye out for that from our vantage point here high above the speedway. As you watch our leader, the 04 Jaguar of Hurley Haywood, 53 laps now in the books.
Screaming on by, the snarl of the cat. Real crowd favorite here. It's a good-looking car. Oh, sound is just wonderful.
Attrition has certainly worked on the side of the Jaguars, which are notoriously dependable machines. You've seen the Ford Probe of Klaus Ludwig go out. Al Holber, who is hoping to win this race for a fourth straight time, has suffered turbo troubles, and he is way back in the field. Right now, Jaguars run 1 and 2.
Of course, you know, Bob, how many races this year have we done? We said, well, Al Holbert is way back and not even a contender. And gee, at the end of the race, Holbert racing in the winner's circle.
And they have a way to come. Now here comes John Andretti on pit road.
See, it looks like they've taped their headlight cover on.
Well, we mentioned that having lost that headlight cover on the right front might have affected the car aerodynamically, so you can see they've made amends. They've taped a new one in place. Watch the clock now. John Andretti and Davy Jones do their stuff.
Yeah, it appears that the last pit stop was very slow in the actual driver change. Again, there's some seat modifications going in there. I really don't know what. To me, both John and Davey look about the same size, but it's a very slow switch. I don't know what this could be.
Well, pit stops have been the bane of this team throughout the season. Earlier this year at one of the races at Watkins Glen, this team, or actually the elder team, the 19 car of Watson Hobbs, was in a position to win the race, but a long pit stop just took them flat out of it. So it's something that they've been working on, obviously, but not quite mastered. Although 40 seconds, 41 seconds, as you see there, not a bad stop at Campbell GT.
I see a long trails of rubber off that car, too. Just doing the burnout.
The anxious Davy Jones coming back on the track. Here is the leader, Hurley Haywood out of Ponte Vedra, Florida.
You can just look very closely and just see Hurley reach up and just adjust something on the cell, or possibly his microphone. But it's very casual 190-mile-an-hour adjustment. Really nothing to worry about.
Not when you raced as often as Hurley Haywood has.
We're going to get a replay here of something that just happened. Now watch the BMW just as he's exiting pit lane. He's on cold tires, and look, the car is not turning properly. He's getting wider, wider, wider. Bang!
Oh! The brake lights were on, he locked up the wheels, and he hit it hard.
Oh, no, no, that is just inexcusable. These people should know that the tires are cold. They've done this before. They've been in this position a number of times. You have to warm up the tires.
Well, let's get a look at it here. He maybe put a lap down by the leader, Hurley Haywood, who's stepping lightly himself. Now, Haywood goes to the inside as Jones keeps the racing line.
Well, Jones is, whoa! Now, there's a little bit of smoke on the back of Jones' car. I don't know if he hasn't damaged that right front suspension, but we're going to see.
There could be a problem with Davy Jones' car, and that's really got to give you some pause when you get up on this 31-degree banking and approach 200 miles an hour.
It really really does. He's braving it out right now because he will be running 175 miles an hour just in a very few weeks. Right about here, he's 170, 175 right there on a car that he doesn't know if he damaged. I would imagine he'll make a pit stop this time around just to come in and have a quick look at it and see if the car is okay. But certainly the team manager is going to have a talk with him.
You see, he's taken another chunk out of that right front headlight cover.
Inexcusable. He left the pits there. Great streaks of rubber off the back of the car. That was unnecessary as well. You don't have to do that. Then got carried away. No.
Now here's an old-style traffic jam among some of our GTO contenders. The 11 car Scott Pruitt is right up there in front. The 9 car Bill Elliott was shown in second place, but Elliott is now on pit road. They've got the hood off, so there's a problem there. The 99 Toyota of Chris Cord is shown in third. Jack Baldwin, therefore, has been put a lap down, as has Bruce Jenner. The second and third cars on your screens there. Scott Pruitt, with a victory, will win the GTO Championship, and the victory for Ford will not win them the title unless Bruce Jenner can come home in third or higher.
Well, I wonder here, the lead two cars in the frame, there's Jack Baldwin. He is still angry about that incident at Columbus, and of course, the fellow that caused it, right in front of him. Jack put any lead-lined bumpers on the car?
Well, by way of background, as they push Bill Elliott's car behind the wall here on pit road, as you watch Scott Pruitt making his way down onto the tri-oval, the big NASCAR tri-oval, which he will shortly leave to head the infield part of the course. Pruitt and Baldwin, by way of background, were involved in a contretemps at Columbus, the latest race of the series 3 weeks ago. Baldwin hit Pruitt, nudged it to one side, arguing it was just racing strategy. They just came together, just racing, as they say. Pruitt basically snapped. He'll tell you that. Scott was so angry at being hit. It was the second time that day he'd been hit previously by Willie T. Ribbs. Scott just drove into Jack. Jack drove into the wall and totally destroyed a brand new race car. There was a lot of ill will after that. Jack Baldwin said, wait until Daytona. Daytona is now, but Jack Baldwin is having all kinds of trouble with his car. And this man, Scott Pruitt, is well out in front.
Yeah, it was really just a most remarkable thing when I watched the films of that Columbus race. Scott did just a totally irresponsible thing by forcing Jack into the wall. And you can sometimes get mad at people, but you can't do that. This is professional level of racing. It was not even a matter of contention as to whether he may or may not have seen Jack. It was a deliberate move forcing him right into that wall. Potentially a very dangerous situation.
Well, it earned Willie T. Ribbs a $2,000 fine. It earned Scott Pruitt a $1,500 fine. And it earned Jack Baldwin a $1,500 fine. Now, we're taking a look at a replay here.
Whoops, sideways.
Little chicane problem here, but he spins back onto the race course and cars scattered everywhere.
Oh, boy, that's Heartburn City. All the GTO cars looked like they got around there with no problems. Double the heartbeat instantly, that's all.
I saw one lone Camel Light competitor in there, too. It was the 63 car of the series champion, Jim Downing, out of my hometown, Atlanta, Georgia. That'll quicken your heartbeat a little bit. So here's your leader, the 04 Jaguar of Early Haywood once again.
Just coming up with a passing Camaro there. It's got a front-end modification.
A good used car in there. Now, here is Scott Pruitt, leading in GTO. We asked Jack Baldwin about the incident that affected him and Scott Pruitt and how it affected, you see Jack back there, how it affected his relationship with Scott.
Now, you've always had the reputation of being an extremely aggressive driver, but never, ever have done anything deliberate. The action at Columbus appeared to many viewers to be deliberate. Do you think it was?
I think it was. I think it was... There's got to be a reason why a man turns left and takes you 2.5 lanes and sticks you in the guardrail and does $40,000 damage to your race car. Now, you could have hit me in the door and let me run.
Well, there you see them, door handle to door handle, and it was all, please, may I get by? Yes, sir, you certainly may. After you, thank you very much, and I'll be on my way. Of course, keep in mind, Jack Baldwin was a lap down.
Oh, boy, their feelings are underway right now.
You can imagine that with Bill Elliott already dropped out of this race, we are informed that he has officially retired. This puts Ford in a situation of some disadvantage. Scott Pruitt now has to be very careful. He has his GTO championship in hand, but he and Bruce Jenner have to work together to score and allow Ford to overtake Chevy in the Manufacturers' Championship. There is the man holding the Chevy host, Jack Baldwin, in a state-of-the-art GTO machine. We're going to take a short break. We'll be back with more live racing as you watch Jack Baldwin making his way around Daytona. Brian Redmond and Hurley Haywood and the Jaguar are your leaders. We're back live at Daytona International Raceway. Bob Barsha and Bill Adam with you. Gary Lee is on pit road, and you're looking at the leader in the third of our racing classes today, the Camel Lights class for lightweight prototype machines. A little bit downsized, a little bit lighter, a little bit less powerful, but every bit as exciting. That 73 car is the Chevy Taiga racer, Howard Katz out of Palisades, New York, and Steve Phillips from Waitsfield, Vermont.
Well, these are just outstanding little cars, and Camel and IMSA wanted to get more participation in the GT prototype ranks. But with the Porsche 962 now costing in excess of $300,000, they're really becoming almost cost prohibitive. These cars, for example, are a third the cost, and they provide outstanding entertainment. They're tremendously competitive cars, and we're getting all sorts of factory inclusion. Jim Downing, as you're well aware, has been our series champion 2 years. Tremendous driver with a Mazda engine car. Now we've got Buick coming in and providing very strong competition. Here, the car leading right now is a brand new Chevrolet engine. They've got to be very pleased with this.
Katz and Phillips remain your leaders. Second in this category is the Mazda-powered Taiga of Ron Canizares and Mike Strawbridge. And in third place, the number 63 car, that's a Mazda-powered Argo racer, the gentleman Bill just referred to, Jim Downing, for the second year running the series champion. Now, Gary Lee is down on pit road with Bill Elliott and more on the GTO story.
Well, Bill Elliott is certainly no stranger to Daytona, but you kind of like the high banks better than the road course, don't you?
Well, it don't make any difference. You know, I enjoy running road courses as well as ovals, but I ought to come down here and drive my log, but yeah, we have a little trouble with the car.
Well, you came down here to help Ford win that GTO manufacturer's title, so what went wrong with the Ford?
Seemed like, look, broke a rocker arm stud the best I can tell. You know, just something you can't do nothing about.
Now just a chance to relax just a bit before going back to the garage area.
Well, I may have to get in for Bruce or something. That's why I'm going to hang around a little while.
All right, so perhaps some relief driving in the future for Bill Elliott.
What did he just say, Bob?
Well, what do you expect from a guy who races those big NASCAR Winston Cup cars 30 weekends a year? What does he do on his day off? He goes out and he races, of course. Don't forget, Bill Elliott will be with us next week in Atlanta, where he'll be racing his big Thunderbird in the next-to-last event on the Winston Cup Trail. It'll be the Atlanta Journal 500, and you'll see it live here Sunday, November 2nd at noon Eastern Standard Time. Bill Elliott will be in there, Dale Earnhardt and Darrell Waltrip, last two surviving protagonists in that battle for one of the richest titles in motorsport.
What a show they put on, too.
There is Hurley Haywood in the 04 Jaguar continuing to lead, really putting a stranglehold on this field. There is the number 5 car. Now, this is probably a scheduled stop, I would guess, Bill. Bob Aiken out, James Weaver back in.
I think it looks everything normal at this point. It's a 4-tire change. Again, tires are so critical in this track. You can't take a chance that you can on other tracks, maybe running down a little bit lower on rubber because of the speed, the centrifugal force being such it is. If you have a blowout at 200 miles an hour, you really destroy the whole car. $300,000 in cracks. Rob Dyson can tell you it's not a lot of fun buying new Porsches.
You mentioned it was a wonderful victory for the Bob Aiken team, driving with Hans Stuck, the present world champion, and the late...
Isn't that nice to see that a pro can stall his car?
Oh, my.
So many people all over the United States just smile.
Jaguar remains your leader. In second place, the 44 Jaguar of Brian Redmond and Bob Tullius and Chip Robinson. In third place right now is being shown the 52 Chevy Corvette. In fourth place, the number 18 BMW car. That's John Jones and Davey Jones and John Andretti car. Followed by the 19 BMW of John Watson and David Hobbs. Running in sixth place is the 16 Porsche of Rob Dyson and Price Cobb. Followed by I thought we were going to have a little problem there as the 04 Jaguar made its way around, and we may have a challenge here.
We've got a definite challenge coming up here. This is where the horsepower of the BMW is helping close right up on the Jag. Very, very interesting. We'll see what happens on the front straight. These cars are coming up to maximum revs. Look at this, trying a little bit of a draft, and I wonder... I don't think he would try challenging under braking because the Jag is so strong, and he would probably follow. Maybe to try and set him up for an infield pass, much the same as Watson did with Vandenberg earlier in the race. Very wide entrance to the corner so that you can get on the gas early. This is the difference in line. You want to turn into a corner early if you want to block somebody, but what that does, it effectively tightens up the corner, and really you can't get back under power as early as you want to. You've got a much tighter corner to go on. You have to be patient. It's a guessing game. Do you go in and turn in early to block, or do you go in late? It's really
get a good exit speed. That was the Jaguar widens out that lead once again. Looks like the 18 car, the BMW, is going to have to wait for just another moment before trying to unlap himself. Gary Lee is standing by on pit road with a question.
Yeah, if I could address this to Bill Adam, let's talk about the points championship in the GTO between Pruitt and Jenner. We just talked to Bill Elliott. He said he's going to stand by just in case he has to drive relief for Jenner. If he drives relief, will they split the points won by the race car and would that effectively take Jenner out of contention for the championship?
As far as I know, Gary, that would. I think that's exactly what would happen. They would split points, so I'd be very surprised if that happens.
So no matter how tired Jenner gets, he has to reach down and grab a little bit more from way down deep because he can't afford to have a relief driver.
Well, let me add my two cents to that. My understanding of the rules, whoa, as we watch chicane action.
Oh, and there is contact.
Contact between the 18 BMW and the GTO car, the Morrison Cook entry, running right behind. Oh, let's see if we can get another look at that. You're watching live action at Daytona. There is a problem there for the BMW team, which has had nothing but problems since their last driver change.
My, geez, really two dramatically different styles. After completing just a flawless first hour, now we're running into problems. Here's the replay coming up. Okay, exiting the chicane. See the Corvette getting a bit wide. Try for an outside pass, and there's no way to do it. Okay, he's off the power now. Everything's still clean, and here comes the Corvette. Just doesn't look in the mirror. The BMW can't get over any further. There's no more track at that point.
So, I believe that was the 88 GTO entry of Bob Carradine and John Heimerse having big traffic problems with the two big overtaking GTP machines. Closing speed always a problem on these circuits when the GTP cars are running so much faster than the GTO cars in the turns.
Now, I saw pieces fly off that car. Now, I don't know whether they come off the Corvette or off the BMW. It's interesting if we could just maybe get a look at the side of the car here. It really doesn't look like there's any damage.
Perhaps the GTO machine got better than it gave.
The back of the car looks fine. Just scraping on the bodywork. Good, strong car, that.
Rocky driving stint for Davy Jones as he follows Early Haywood and tries to unlap himself. Both cars there passing the number 11 Ford Mustang of Scott Pruitt, who remains the GTO leader, on the long backstretch.
As you made mention, this is a problem in a race like this. And I think IMSA was very wise to stop GTU cars, very small cars like the RX-7s and the Fieros, running in this race. Because you're getting speed differential of 70 and 80 miles an hour. And it only takes one mistake. It's just an instant disaster.
There you see the 52 car shown as third on the racetrack, pitting now.
We got word here that it's a broken exhaust header. If that's the case, that means the turbo boost is going away.
Could be a problem. So Wally Dallenbach will get out of that car. Back in will go the turbo expert on this team, Sarel Vandemerve, to complete the stint. That could be a crippled car, we're being told. And the drama will continue to grow the rest of the day. Now, here is your leader, the Jaguar, the 04 team. And these guys really know their stuff on pit stops.
Oh, they were spectacular yesterday, winning the Kodak pit stop competition. Just a beautiful display of teamwork. I believe it was 23 seconds flat. They did tire changes, refueling, and windshield cleaning. Great teamwork. All my old friends there.
Saw Hurley Haywood get out, Brian Redmond back in. No loss of driver talent there as Redmond is up and away.
I believe the Group 44 team learned their trade from Dead Bear Racing in Simcoe, Ontario.
Spoken like a true Canadian. Now here is the 52 car, still in the pits. The hood is now up, and this could be really serious. Sarel Vandemerve is saying, please clean my windshield. As soon as they put that hood down, I need to be out of here.
Yeah, he's having trouble seeing it again with the sun getting lower and lower in that sky. You're coming down the front straight, and there's just tremendous problems.
Oh, and we've had another problem on pit road. The 16 Porsche, just behind the Corvette there, entered the pits. We have a problem. Okay, we're continuing to look at the problems facing the 52 car. Just as these guys were working, in came the 16 Porsche of Rob Dyson and Price Cobb, and that car just looped on pit road. They've got it straightened out once again, and they're going to push the car back into their pits and go through the pit routine. But that was a very near thing on pit road.
This looks ominous here. You can see they're checking the exhaust pipe. Oh,
wow. Must have been a cool suit failure or something. Hurley Haywood is having terrible heat problems here.
Yeah, we've got serious problems here. It looks like Hurley is literally just passing out.
Now we have word that Hurley really did faint. They've got him back on his feet, talking with his crew chief, Lanky Boucher, there, and a nice bag on the back of his head.
Now, we have talked about these cool suits, and sometimes what can happen is if you pinch a line, the suit tends to even hurt you more than what would normally be the heat inside the car.
Okay, we'll follow the Jaguar story as you watch your GTO leader, Scott Pruitt, now on pit road. This is probably a scheduled stop. Tires and fuel, he'll be back on his way. Pruitt well out in front. He may not lose a position on this pit stop. We'll keep track of that. Meanwhile, the 44 Jaguar has taken over for the 04 Jag on the lead. There's a look at Scott Pruitt, standing firmly in line to win his first GTO championship with a good performance today. Much of his competition has gone by the wayside. Jack Baldwin was lapped down. Willie T. Ribbs dropped out. The action continues and the drama is growing as we move toward our third hour here at Daytona International Raceway. Scott Pruitt makes his way down pit road. There are four pit stops to come, more action on the racetrack. We'll be back at Daytona live on ESPN after this. W here at Daytona continue. Just moments ago, Jones limped onto pit road with a totally destroyed right rear tire.
I think that was probably as a result of the contact with the Corvette, the chicane that we saw. The little bit of fiberglass you saw flying off really acts like a knife edge, and it can just slash the tires. Racing tires are designed with thin sidewalls, and you can't use these in a street car. You scuff a curb once, and it would wear through that rubber, and the tire would leak right away.
You saw the wheel spin there on the rear wheels. They're probably having them let out the clutch so they can see whether or not they're getting contact between body parts and tires. Davy Jones behind the wheel of the 18 BMW. He was shown in third position on the racetrack, but this is going to cost him that. The Jaguars continue to lead first and second positions to the 44 and 04 cars, respectively. And in third, now being shown the 19 BMW machine.
Well, exiting the pits again. Hopefully he's going to make it out of the pit lane this time without any problems with the guardrail.
Crew members arguing here. Taking a look at the left front.
Oh, they're going to change the noses.
Oh, my. Whoa.
You can see that really is beat up.
Not an exercise and good pit work here.
Oh, no, that's really bad. Continued frustration.
Well, once again, with a whole race car, Davy Jones makes his way down the pit road. Now, remember, he hit the wall last time through here. Let's see how he works it this time. Carefully. Okay, there we go. Davy Jones is back on the racetrack, shown somewhere out of the top five. Back to the leader. Here is Chip Robinson in the 44 Jaguar, a graduate of the Super V ranks at SCCA competition. He even made an IndyCar start this year.
Chip has really been an outstanding find for the Bob Tullius organization. Oh, as I say that, he gets sideways going into the corner. But held the slide very nicely, no problems. Chip has really driven very smoothly. It's a shame that he hasn't been rewarded with a win because he's put in some sparkling performances this year.
This is a big weekend of racing here at Daytona, and let's pause for a moment here to give you an idea of what's been going on. Yesterday, in the return of open-wheel racing to Daytona for the first time in 11 years, Willie Lewis won the Barber Pro Sob race, followed by a 100-kilometer race for GTU cars, the smaller machines Bill mentioned earlier, and Roger Mandeville bade goodbye to the GTU ranks with a victory. In today's Champion Spark Plug race for front-wheel drive sedans, Cal Choquette came up a winner, followed by his teammate Phil Curran in a 1-2 Dodge sweep. And in the Kelly American Challenge for full-size domestic American sedans similar to stock cars, Irv Hare won his 9th out of 10 races this year. He has just dominated Kelly Racing this year.
Tremendous record.
Now, as we watch our leader, let's run down the top five. In those other classes, you saw Willie Lewis, the victor in the open wheel class. Jeremy Dale followed him to the line, followed by Brian Till, Ken Murillo, and David Rocha. Very, very tough competition between those identically prepared cars. Roger Mandeville over the Pontiac of Terry Visger, Durkheimer, Bacon, and Kendall all follow. In the Champion Spark Plug, Choquette and Curran, a 1-2 finish, followed by the Mazda of Amos Johnson. And in the Kelly American Challenge, Irv Hare and Dick Danielson. Notice the two women in fourth and fifth place, Patty Moise and Robin Dahlenbach, who is also, by the way, the wife of one Wally Dahlenbach Jr. So it's a family affair here at Daytona this weekend as you watch Chip Robinson making his way around to the lead.
Real racing family, the Dahlenbachs. There's a father, of course, of Indianapolis fame, and now son and daughter-in-law.
Okay, we're going to take another short break here. The racing continues live. We've got about an hour still to come. Stay with us here live on ESPN. Jaguars in first and second, BMW third, Porsche fourth. his way through the kinks, but don't let that fool you. Just a moment ago, Chip Robinson got the surprise of his life, Phil.
Well, just deep, deep under braking, and look what happens. The rear end is locked up, and the car is sideways, spinning into turn one. Look at the smoke. Oh, those tires are baking. This is going to take a pit stop because he has badly flat-spotted these tires. At that point in the track, he's braking from 185 miles an hour down to about 50. You can see what happened.
And you notice the headlights of Al Holbert coming by underneath. The 14 car still in the thick of it. Chip Robinson making his way gently around. There is definitely a handling problem with that car.
I don't know if I've jinxed Chip, but I've never seen him have any problems. Then I tell you what a great driver he is. Living color, he gets sideways in front of us all.
An incredible driver. I remember his qualifying run at West Palm Beach, a race we did live here on ESPN. He just electrified the crowd, just spinning that car through the twisting turns of that street course. An amazing performance. Really a talented driver.
Very, very good. It's funny, that came to mind too, because he was sitting beside Cyril Vandenberg that day. I think Cyril was on the pole, and Cyril would have had at least 200 horsepower more,
and there they were on the grid, like 3/1000ths of a second apart.
Tremendous performance, Chip.
Perhaps we can reminisce back to Lime Rock as well, a race live up here on ESPN, when Chip Robinson, in the rain, set the track record, but didn't get the pole because of the single car qualifying for it. Definitely an all-arounder.
Well, Chip is hanging pretty low on the banking here, and I would suspect that he may make a duck into the fence just to get four new tires, or at the very least get them checked. Yeah, he's D is going to come back. Oh, this costs dearly.
Still being shown as the leader. Bob Tullius is standing by.
I will be very surprised if Bob... Oh, boy. Now, that's why they use an orange pylon in front of the car instead of a crew member.
That is really scary, and that's exactly the reason I was going to bring up, Bill. Often it's your crew chief standing there holding that pit board. Oh, my.
Or maybe use a crew member you don't like very much.
Well, so Chip Robinson has gotten out of the car. Bob Tullius is going to take it over once again, and you've got to believe that Chip Robinson is whispering a few words into the ears of Bob Tullius about how that car is handling right now. It's a handful.
He's saying, sorry, boss.
Well, in the meantime, the 04 Jaguar has taken over once again. We said it was going to be a tag team contest. It turned into exactly that. 04 Jaguar now out front. The 44 car shown second. BMW, the 19 machine of John Watson and David Hobbs. Third, the 68 BF Goodrich machine of Darren Brassfield and John Marcus. Fourth, number 0 Jaguar, the Wallach, Barilla, and Winter machine is fifth. 70 laps down.
Well, the 44 car now has less than an hour to go, and it would, without doubt, be able to run the balance of the race without making any further pit stops. 04 car, at this point, we don't know. It really is a guessing game. It may have to be just for a splash of fuel, not even a full stop. You just leave the tires on, you plug the fuel hose in, just for a moment. You just want 10 gallons, 5 gallons, whatever you can do in a few seconds, and get back onto the track.
You see the shadows growing long. Turn banking down there, turn one of the NASCAR track. Totally enveloped in shadow now as he comes back into the sunlight. It's in his mirrors as he heads down the long backstretch.
This is a nice part for drivers. You're driving with the benefit of the sun, and everything is perfectly clear in front of you. You can see very, very well. But what happens is that after you go through the chicane, you get up on the stock car bank in turn 3 and 4 here, and then you come down this front straight. The sun is so low on the horizon, you're looking right through the windshield. It really is a hit for you.
Gary Lee is now standing by. We showed you a few moments ago a very overheated Hurley Haywood. He is back on his feet, and Gary Lee has got him now.
Well, indeed, he is back on his feet. One of the first drivers down to ask if he was all right was Al Holbert. And I saw you look up and say, I'm fine. So exactly what did happen? Just too hot?
We wear full cool suits on the head and on the on your chest, and mine wasn't working. And it's so hot that the heat can't escape, and you know, for the first half an hour you can live with it, but that second half an hour was murder, and I was just making a lot of mistakes, and I called in and said I needed to come in a little early. I came in about 4 laps early, and Brian was ready, but those things, when they work, are great, but when they don't work, they're absolutely kill you.
So right now, for the rest of the day, take your time, relax, and let somebody else do all the work out there.
Yeah, but Brian is doing a great job. We're back in first, so if nothing goes wrong, we should do all right.
I think I can get Chip Robinson, who is standing right behind us here. Chip, in fact, there is the cool suit vest that he's wearing under the driving suit right now. They're great as long as they work, but when they go, we'll see. We want you to walk walk down and take a look at a monitor with us momentarily, but quickly right now, what happened?
Well, I don't really know. I thought I was going in just about the way I always had, and I either hit a bump differently or maybe threw the brakes a little bit too hard at one point or something, and it just got sideways and I couldn't catch it, and it's fun.
We'll go back to the racing right now and then come back and have you check out that monitor.
Okay, great.
Well, it looked like Chip's cool suits worked, and he appeared quite comfortable. And as Hurley said, when these suits don't work, they're a nylon composition material, and they really do hold the heat in. It's the most uncomfortable feeling possible.
The temperature on the racetrack in the bright sunlight is probably approaching 90 degrees, although there's a good wind blowing. Here's a look at the 68 and 16 machines duking it out a little bit. Bryce Cobb in the 16 machine, he is two laps down, whereas the 68 car is presently shown seventh position on the racetrack, and Darren Brassfield behind the wheel. So a battle there as Bryce Cobb tries to work his way back up through the field in a machine that was badly wrecked in practice, put back together overnight, and is back out on the racetrack today.
I got a bit worried there just watching Price pass that 68 car. They almost came in contact. That very high-speed section of track, that could have been a very bad move for both.
Running quickly through the order as it presently stands, the only two cars on the lead lap, Ryan Redmond and Bob Tullius in the Jaguars. Shown one lap down in third is John Watson in the 19 BMW, Paolo Barilla in the 0 Porsche. We've got Davey Jones in the 18 BMW in fifth position, Tom Gloyd, a Ford Probe, sixth, Brassfield, seventh in the Porsche, James Weaver, eighth in the number 5 Porsche, all one lap down. In ninth position, John Hodgkiss and Jim Adams sharing the Porsche, two laps down. Now we have, as we mentioned, there's the number 2 car. That's Tom Gloy in the Probe, just crawling down pit road. Obviously a problem with that turbo car. Smoke coming out the back, Bill.
Yeah, it looks like he's coasting. I would think that maybe the turbo has said enough's enough. And you can see that he's getting the door up, just ready to tell the crew what's going on here. Doesn't look good at all. Really a rough day for Ford. They're pulling directly behind the wall, so their car is out.
Day is over for the Ford team.
Oh, that's, and look at this.
Whoa, that is the second, excuse me, that's the leader. That's Brian Redmond.
Now, that was strange. This is the chicane on the back straight that Brian got too deep, got sideways going into. You can see when he pulled back on the track, the car also got a little bit sideways going the other direction.
I'm wondering about the racing surface, Bill. We haven't had any rain this weekend. We had an awful lot of racing. The cars are just going off right and left now.
Well, it shouldn't be too bad as yet. We're going to get a replay, actually, on the Brian Redmond thing. And here he is coming into a very deep braking area. Look at this, going past the rubber. He knows he's in trouble, but he stays very, very smooth. Brian's a veteran. He didn't panic. Drove the car back on. And here he wants to step back on the gas. Whoop, little slide there.
Just kick that tail around and go. Brian Redmond, they don't come any better than that.
That's where a veteran is really worth his money.
No damage to the car. Brian Redmond making his way around to use the grass to slow himself down there. No damage to the tires. No need to stop.
Yeah, that in itself could be a bit of a trick. These cars do run with a 2-inch ground clearance. It really doesn't take much of a bump to tear up the fiberglass.
Now, we mentioned that Brian Redmond is certainly a veteran driver. And Gary Lee went and asked him, at age 49, Brian, how long can you keep it up? And here's what he had to say.
Where will you be in 3 or 4 years? Now, you're one of the... We always say a veteran driver, okay? And then we got to laugh about it. You've got a few years under the belt. How many more years are you looking down the road?
Well, you know, if you'd asked me that 10 years ago, I would have said 1 or 2 years. 10 years ago. Today, I feel fine, and I'm trying to keep fit. I'm driving fine as well. And don't forget, the professional drivers are only employed as long as they drive professionally. When you stop performing, you stop being employed. So I'll keep driving as long as people will employ me.
I have to apologize to Brian Redmond. I said 49 years of age. I must have been listening to you, Bill. 45 years of age. I beg your pardon, Brian. You certainly lost nothing in my estimation, and now you've got 4 extra years to do it. Here's a fact for you, 115 miles an hour, the average speed with 45 minutes to go in the race. That beats the race record of 107 miles an hour. So you can see just how rapidly things are happening here. Plenty more racing to come. Stay with us, folks.
The BMW 735i is one of those rare luxury sedans engineered by driving enthusiasts. while other luxury sedans announced.
Big drama here at Daytona. You're watching the 44 Jaguar of Bob Tullius, had been second, now shown as third. He was passed by the BMW, and that was only the beginning of his troubles. Gary Lee is standing by with Chip Robinson. Go ahead, Gary.
Chip, we were going to watch this monitor to tell what happened with your spin, but right now there are some other serious problems on the racetrack with your teammate.
Yeah, I can't quite tell what's happening. It looked like he spun or something in turn five, but now it looks like there's some problem. I saw smoke coming out of the car on the back straight, and I think he's on his way, and there it is.
Oh, there he is, just not turning, just simply going off the racetrack before we saw the smoke. Any indication what that could have been?
Yeah, it looked like maybe a tire went down or something, because then coming around, a lot of smoke coming off the right front wheel, so maybe that had something to do with it.
But I don't know if we can go back to the video that we had a little earlier of you, because you were out there just before your pit stop, and I think, in fact, you were about to make the pit stop. What happened here?
Well, the car started coming around on me, going down into turn one, and I just couldn't catch it. After I came in, talked to the Goodyear guy, he said my rear tires were down to just about nothing, so that was probably part of the cause.
You, in fact, were coming in the very next lap?
No, I don't know when I was coming in. We come in when we run out of fuel, and I hadn't run out yet. It probably would have been another lap or two.
Well, there's your teammate in the pit area right now, and we can see some work going on in the front of the car.
Yeah, it looks like something went wrong when he went off there. They're getting it fixed, it looks like, though.
I know it's got to be very, very frustrating having had such a great drive this afternoon for both Jags to see what happened now.
Well, the car was running great. It was just running fantastically, and it's really too bad. I was hoping for a 1-2.
Guys, I got to tell you how disappointing a driver can be, but what a great sport Chip has been to walk down here, take a look at the monitor, and join us for his expert commentary.
Okay, we'll certainly add our thanks to Chip Robinson for that. Now, here was the number 9 car. This is the Porsche of John Hotchkiss and Jim Adams. He's got tire problems.
Real serious problems. Not only a tire, but look at the way that wheel is flopping. He's either broken an axle or else part of it, the hubs. There's something seriously wrong with that suspension. Obviously, he doesn't realize that it is just the tire. He's hoping it's the tire, but sorry, not this race.
He was seen in 9th place, the number 10 car. Let's keep that straight. But John Hotchkiss and Jim Adams are obviously going to drop back. Now we go back to your leader, the 04 Jaguar, presently shown as the only car on the lead lap. In 2nd place is the number 19 BMW of John Watson and David Hobbs. The 44 Jaguar is still being shown in 3rd position, but we'll have to update that because of that long pit stop to change the nose on that car and get the bodywork off the tire. In 4th position, the 18 BMW, that's the Jones and Andretti machine. And in 5th place, the Dyson and Price Cobb Porsche number 16. And that car has big implications for Price Cobb. He is in the running for the North American Porsche Cup as we take a look at Brian Redmond making his way around in the lead. And what a great victory it would be for them.
I hope I'm wrong, but that car looks like it's going awfully slowly at this point.
It is
not accelerating. It's definitely going slowly. The 04 car has got problems. All of the tires look up. There's no smoke up. Now look at this. GTO car is blowing by.
Down on the apron. That's not a good sign.
Oh, no. Just disaster in the course of 2 laps for the Jaguar team. Solid 1-2 position. They're both in trouble now.
How could we have written a script any better? The two teams that are apparently, if you believe the rumors, in trouble in the Camel GT Series, the BMW team and the Jaguar team. Two cars for each team. Jaguar first, BMW second, Jaguar third, BMW fourth. And right now, it appears that the only healthy car on the racetrack among those four is the number 19 machine in the hands of John Watson. As we watch Brian Redmond crawling down the pit apron as agonizingly slowly as possible.
Well, he is just limping down, and I can't see any activity with the pit crew at all. I think they know that it's something that's terminal.
No smoke out of the car that we can see. They're going to throw the jack on, get it up, and take a look.
Yeah, there's not a lot of action. That looks very, very bad.
Let's go down to Gary Lee, who's once again down in the Jaguar pit area.
Well, you guys are right in your assessment. There is no appearance of urgency here. They took the left front wheel off. They checked the suspension. They checked the axle on the left rear. So apparently there is a bit of concern, but yet they really don't know where to go. The engine is off. The driver is still in the cockpit. But obviously no urgency down here. Hurley Haywood Any indication right now what the problem is?
I don't know what the problem is.
Well, so a team driver has no idea, the crew has no idea, and the work continues, but not very quickly.
Okay, thank you, Gary. You see a couple of crewmen at the back of the car turning the rear wheels and looking under there. Bill, would you guess differential transmission?
Yeah, something like that. Something that you're also going to talk about, possibly a CV joint, one of the constant velocity joints in the axle. Usually, if you're wiggling the wheel like what he was a few minutes ago, you're checking for excessive play there.
Okay, preliminary indications from pit road now are there's a clutch problem with the 04 Jaguar. Shift linkage, transmission, all drivetrain related. That would be too bad, but here is someone who's got to be exulting. John Watson in the number 19 BMW. You saw the problems that they had early with the car. Now they are out in front.
Boy, this is a really impressive car, this thing. He ran this car so hard in so many laps. I really wondered if he might not be the rabbit of the team. And in fact, a car that really isn't designed to. Competition, but he not only broke the competition, the car is still running very, very strong and it's flawless. There's not a mark on the car.
John Watson making his way through the infield one more time. Watson, you may know, is a Formula One veteran. He drove for the McLaren team, won the initial Detroit Grand Prix, and McLaren fans everywhere are exulting today because this morning you saw it on ESPN. Alain Prost in Australia won. He came from behind to win the Australian Grand Prix and with it, the World Championship. A terrible disaster for Nigel Mansell. He had a tire explode, pulled off the course, did a tremendous piece of driving. Nelson Piquet appeared to be in it, but a late pit stop put him just too far behind to catch Alain Prost, who is now a two-time world champion. Back-to-back titles. Great, great race. You can look for highlights of that and all of motorsports action next week on Speed Week.
I talk of everything he knows.
Yeah, sure. Meanwhile, here is John Watson using all of the savvy learned in Formula One to carry the BMW team to victory. Alone on the lead lap, we have now had six different leaders. 19 has become the sixth leader. John Watson making his way around, following the Corvette, the Zero Porsche, the 18 BMW car, and both Jaguars. Along pit road, we're still seeing drivetrain problems on the 04 Jaguar. Oh, what a tragedy for a great, great team. Plenty of racing still to come. More than a half an hour to go in the Eastern Airlines Camel GP. Stay with us.
There came a moment when all the elements came together, unleashing a superbly equipped new breed of compact car, the Dodge Shadow. With two or four door availability, affordable price, a $550 protection plan, the new Dodge Shadow is going to cast a giant shadow across America. Dodge, setting new standards of performance.
Twisting roads, punishing trails, the open road. Each road demands a different tire to take it on. And with BF Goodrich TA radios, you've got all the different tires you need to take on those roads. The most complete line of high-performance radios in the world. The BF Goodrich TA line, built for you to take on the road.
To America's best, as they look to Australia and the America's Cup Challenge.
It's one thing to say you fight friction. It's another thing to prove it. Kendall Motor Oil did. First, ordinary piston rings were plated with pure gold.
Live at Daytona International Speedway, where you're watching John Watson leading the way in the Eastern Airlines three-hour finale of the Camel Grand Prix season. It's been a great year here on ESPN for these racers, and it's been a great year for the racers themselves. Here is Jack Baldwin now, coming onto pit road. Now, he is presently shown on the racetrack in third position among GTO. Now, Scott Pruitt continues to lead, but Baldwin has passed Pruitt's teammate Bruce Jenner, which means that Ford is hanging on by its fingernails in the battle for the car maker championship. If Jack Baldwin finishes third, Scott Pruitt finishes first, then Ford will win the manufacturer's title. But if Jack Baldwin can move up and overtake the second place car, the 99 Toyota Turbo being driven by Chris Ford, then Chevy will win that permanent title.
And what an incredible car this is. This is just the most high-tech studio car that has ever been built. It looks like a Camaro, but it's a carbon fiber car. Really ultra-sophisticated.
Anything like the Spring Machine. Now, updating our situation with the Jaguars on the lead, we have Gary Lee standing by with Brian Redman.
When it appeared to be well in hand, then what happened?
I guess we're doing something wrong. Maybe I'll start going to church.
When you came in, they looked at the right rear axle, the half shaft, if you will. They pulled it out to replace it, found that there was nothing wrong with it. Do you have any idea now what the problem was?
It was an engine problem, terminal.
On inside the mine when everything is in a rhythm, everything is going well, then without warning something breaks.
Well, I'd like to be able to tell you, but I can't. It's not fit for human consumption.
We're on cable. Never mind, we'll get in trouble with that.
Right.
You know,
what happens? There you are. You think you're going to win your first race in 18 months, and with 30 minutes to go with an easy lead, you're great.
There is comment now that there may be only one Jag next year. That cuts the driving force in half. Where does that leave you?
I wish I knew, and I think all of the drivers are in the same position. We don't really know what's happening. We know that Jaguar will be back. We know that they will do a limited number of races, but we don't know how many.
So one out, one Jag still in the fray with Bob Tullius at the wheel.
Okay, thank you very much, Gary. Less than half an hour to go as this man, John Watson, continues to lead the race. 8 laps now in the books. BMWs in first and third position. 19 car out front, 44 Jaguar sandwiched by the 18 machine. Now there you see the time remaining in this 3-hour race. In fourth place right now is Price Cobb, and getting back to the point I was making about Price before our commercial break, he leads in the North American Porsche Cup competition, which honors the most outstanding driver of a Porsche machine in the series. Price Cobb can win that with a good performance today, and it's worth a lot of money. There is David Hobbs, the endurance veteran, also a Formula One veteran, standing by in case John Watson needs help. With a half an hour left to go, Bill, what do you suppose the chances they may see John Watson?
Well, I expect it. They're considering putting David back in the car. Not from a talent standpoint, because he's a brilliant driver. He posed an enviable record. But possibly it's getting a little hot inside the car. Maybe they just want to give John some relief that way. And if necessary, David can go very, very quickly in this car.
Well, certainly, for the sake of speed of their pit stop, they wouldn't want to have to make a driver change. Although they are alone on the lead lap now, the 44 Jaguar would have an awful lot of ground to make up.
Yeah, I think if they can keep that lap lead, that's an awful nice luxury to have getting in the late stages of the race. But if the temperature is bad inside the car, then it would be a very wise move to have a fresh driver in there.
We've had two caution flags in today's race. There you see the average speed, 114 miles an hour. It's the absolute shatter of the 3-hour race record set 2 years ago by Al Holbert at 107.394 miles an hour. Great, great racing today. Watch a little bodywork flapping on the BMW. He heads once more up onto the high banking at Daytona. Jared Watson driving through the lengthening shadows here at Daytona. Once more down the long back straightaway, braking hard for the chicane.
You know, it's amazing. It seems that in automobile racing, more than any other sport, you just really don't get any idea of the true feeling of it. We're watching this car out. This particular point right here, 125, 130 miles an hour. Does it give you that impression?
Let me check my figures. We have 6 cars still on the lead lap, so that gives us even more reason why they wouldn't want to replace drivers on this, your leading BMW. So 6 cars on the lead lap, led by the number 19 machine of John Watson. We'll be back with more racing.
What sets Jermé Pontiac Buick apart from all the rest? In one word, dedication. Dedication to serving you before, during, and after the sale. And now we have been recognized as a 5-star service dealer by Pontiac Motor Division, their highest service award given, for our commitment to excellence in customer satisfaction and quality workmanship. And you're the winner at Jim May Pontiac.
BMW being driven by John Watson. Earlier, Bill Adam, my cohort here, mentioned that you can never count out Al Holbert. Now, Holbert early on, remember, had turbo problems. He dropped a long way back. They are now being shown in 10th place on the racetrack. There you see the number 14 car, Derek Bell, the reigning world champion for the second year in a row. Now, Gary Lee is standing by with Al Holbert.
Well, before we talk to Al, let's mention that many drivers have been known to lie about their age. Here's one driver that really can't. This is a wanted poster that has appeared throughout the weekend here at Daytona. No one is taking the credit or the blame for it, but it says wanted Derek Bell for attempted escape from his 45th birthday. No reward. Caution. If this dangerous outlaw is sighted, please contact the nearest track security guard for assistance. His birthday happens to be on Halloween. I don't know if this rascal here has anything at all to do with this. What can you tell me about these wanted posters?
Well, Derek's a bad character. Everybody knows that. And I think it's about time somebody would be looking for
him. On a more serious note, you came into the race having clinched the GT title. The effort was underway to get the point for Derek to take second place. Where does he stand right now?
Well, it's a close deal. You know, if we can... I thought he had to gain or maintain a three-point lead. He thinks he needs to maintain an eight-point lead. If it's 8 points, if that's what the story is, then he's all right. He's inched up into eighth position in GTP versus the number 16 car, Price Cobb, who's in fourth. That would give him 7-point advantage, not eight. So they're both going to have to keep running hard right to the end.
So it's going to be a shootout for the final, 30 minutes or so?
Yeah, we're wallowing around back in the middle, but maybe we can preserve something.
And he's going to stay in the race car?
Yeah, he's going to be a hero today.
You have to stay out because your shoe's off right now.
Yeah, my foot, I got a huge blister on it, and it won't stop, and it hurts.
I'm the five-time GT champion enjoying a restful view from the pit area here on a Sunday afternoon in Daytona.
Okay, thank you, Gary. I was doing the arithmetic here in my pad up in the booth, but Al has obviously done it for you. Derek Bell is maintaining position. In fact, he's gaining position. His battle with Price Cobb, presently shown in fourth position in the number 16 Porsche, to battle for second place in the year-end standings. There you see the numbers on Derek Bell. 3 wins, 13 top 10 finishers, and late in the race with a charge to be made, Bill Adam, I don't think there's anybody I'd rather have in a car.
Oh, well, he has given us just some of the most spectacular performances this year. It's very typical. That is Derek Bell. Put him in a good car like Al Holbert's Porsche here and let him go play. And he loves it. He always responds to a terrific challenge. What a talent that man is.
And there you see the leader, the number 19 car of John Watson, about to put a lap on the number 68 machine. Darren Brasfield and John Morton, that will put them a lap down in fifth position. So 4 cars now on the lead lap.
Well, that car just looks so good. The more I watch it, the more impressed I am on the job that John Dix and Avery Donaldson have done with this BMW team since reorganizing it. It really is a spectacularly good car, excellent corners. You can watch it. It puts the power down very, very well. Oh, got a little bobbler. I hope that's all it was.
And the 19 car is slowing.
No, that's more than a bobble. I thought he made just missed the shift and lost the boost, but it's very good. He's accelerating there, but...
Okay, now remember, early in the race, this car stopped on the pit apron, trying to reach its pit, stopped dead without a sign of damage on it, too early for fuel. Turns out it was an electrical problem that John Watson was able to remedy. I wonder if we're seeing that again, Bill.
I don't know. It almost looked intermittent because it looked like the car was dead for a moment, then it picked up and accelerated stronger. Oh, no.
Oh, bad problem here. This is the 18 car of Davy Jones and John Andretti. Had been seen in fifth position on the racetrack. It is obviously dead to the world now.
I think we're going to have to stop talking about people because every time we put someone on, their car breaks down.
Oh, my. And the teams that we talked about, the teams that needed the win so badly, the Jaguars seemed to have this race by the throat, and then they both suffered problems. Now, here the BMW cars are suffering problems. 18 is dead. 19 has got 1 foot in the grave and 1 on the banana peel.
This is incredible. The team dropouts are just staggering right now. Ford having all of that problem right at the start of the race with 2 out of their 3 cars going. Third one really didn't last a great deal longer. Then the Jags.
There goes the Jaguar. You saw the 44 car sweep into the lead. That puts the 44 Jaguar team, which just a few moments ago was wallowing in the throes of despair, they are once again back out in front.
I'm expecting Bo Derek to appear at any time and take the Academy Award.
Oh, My, we're going to go right to the finish, folks. Don't go away from this one. There is David Hobbs looking up pit road for his teammate to be so close to a victory. The second victory for this team, it would have been. And for this man who has put in so many hours and so many miles of developing not only the BMW prototype, he also did most of the development work, did David Hobbs, on the Chevrolet Corvette prototype.
Very instrumental in that car. He drove that a number of times in the latter part of last season when they unveiled the car at Road America, Wisconsin. He drove right through to the end of the year, and then BMW came along and offered him a ride for the season.
Well, there is your new leader. It's the Tullius Robinson car being presently driven by Bob Tullius. Lots of action. This one will go right down to the wire. Stay with us. We'll be back in a few moments.
The front-wheel drive Dodge Lancer is the performance sedan that will thrill you all the way to the red line. Hold you to the dotted line. Cover you down the line. And impress you with its bottom line. Dodge Lancer, with prices starting at $98.52, setting new standards of performance.
Dawn at the track, where speed and heat work relentlessly to break down motor oil. This is where we put Quaker Steak motor oil to the ultimate test. This is our laboratory, where we make sure Quaker Steak measures up to our standards and yours. Because people who care about their cars don't cut corners on quality. Quaker Steak, the big Q stands for quality.
For all those confident with an amazingly agile suspension, a computer-controlled engine that constantly adjusts to changing driving conditions, and an ingenious anti-lock braking system, the 535i, it lets those who take driving seriously peacefully coexist with those who don't.
We're back live at Daytona International Speedway, where the three-hour Eastern Airlines Camel GT race drawing to a close. Drama has simply not ceased. Here is the number 44 Jaguar, presently being driven by Bob Tullius. The car has been totally off the racetrack twice, yet, like Methuselah, it just keeps coming back.
Wow, taking pages of Hulbert Racing once again. This car is running strong, and I'm almost afraid to talk about it. Every time we do, we seem to be getting a new leader.
Now there behind them, you see Bruce Jenner in a Ford Mustang. Jenner holding down fourth place in the GTO category. That title may be in Scott Pruitt's hands, but the Manufacturers' Championship still very much up for grabs.
Out of gas. Here's a picture of David Hobbs with a small fuel tank. Now, he has to go down and do this refueling himself. He cannot get assistance from a crew member. If that should happen, if somebody else were to carry that to the car, immediate disqualification.
Okay, there's David Hobbs. Good point, Bill. Good that you mentioned. The rules require that the driver do all of the work on the car. So those aren't exactly running shoes that David Hobbs is carrying, that, what would you guess, 50 or 60-pound fuel tank in addition to his driver's suit, the cool suit, the helmet. It is not a pleasant walk for David Hobbs.
Not at all. I can imagine what David is saying inside his helmet. Ryan Redmond's comments were suitable for consumption, and David certainly won't be.
In the meantime, you see the number 44 Jaguar of Bob Tullius making his way around Jack Baldwin. Baldwin hanging in there in... Whoa! Jack Baldwin not exactly giving way there.
There is an idea of just how fast that Camaro is. That was a fairly long straight, and the Jag did not gain on the Camaro. A very fast car. He made his pass. All right, now this is legal. We're seeing David sitting on a cart, and that particular part is legal. Once he gets onto the traveled surface on the racetrack, he's the only one that can do it. He has to physically carry that out himself and do the refueling.
Now, for the sake of your perspective, they are pulling out of the garage area. They have to go all the way down to the stock car turn four. They've got about a half a mile of driving in that little 10-mile-an-hour cart. So, as you can see, this problem is going to be semi-terminal for the Jaguar team. You mentioned Jack Baldwin's car, as we see, just a little over a quarter of an hour left in this three-hour race. Jack Baldwin's car is capable of trap speed approaching 190 miles an hour. It's a GTO car.
Oh, it's an incredible car.
Jack Jaguar. We've had 9 lead changes among 6 different drivers. There once again the number 5 car of Bob Aiken and James Weaver. I made a point earlier about the Sebring victory of Bob Aiken driving with Hans Stuck and the late Joe Gardner. Of course, that team saddened tremendously by the untimely death of Gardner in a crash at Le Mans this past May. James Weaver has come to drive with Bob Aiken and has been a terrific addition to the team. Hans Stuck was to have driven that car, Stuck being Derek Bell's co-champion in the World Championships this year. Stuck had a motorcycle accident at his home in Germany. Fell off, landed on his head or his feet or whichever, at least could not drive. And so James Weaver stepped in. They're in good shape right now, presently shown in 5th place on the racetrack and a lap down.
Well, old Hans should have been nice and safe inside one of these GT cars, not on a motorcycle. They are handy.
Bob Tullius, and you can imagine that Bob isn't taking anything for granted until he reaches the finish line. Has been off the track twice. Bob took it once in a terrific slide through the infield. But thus far, it's got all the numbers on its side.
Yeah, we're starting to see some of the problems the drivers are having with this very late afternoon sun. When the car was going through the infield there, you can see the sun is clearly on Bob's face. Again, with this windshield problem, with all the grease and oil and rubber all over the windshield, the reflection is just about unbelievable. You almost can't see through it. And there are instances where you come out of the turn that the stock car turns forward, coming down the front straight, you only drive by watching the reflection of the sun off the painted lines of the pavement. You literally cannot see in front of you.
Dice here between Julius and the big GTD Jaguar and the smaller Camel Lights car.
That's very kicking this little fab car there. Beautiful Camel Lights.
Updating the gap between first and second positions, Bob Julius has 34.15 seconds over Bryce Cobb. Now, Cobb is presently up to second place. Derek Bell is still in eighth place. Might be in jeopardy in that second place position. There's the Jaguar moving around the 961 Porsche. That Porsche that we talked about, that four-wheel drive car, is competing in the GTX category. It's not competing for money. It's so different technologically from all of the other cars in the GTP, the Camel Lights, the GTO, the GTU categories. Class called GTX for experimental, and it's basically a class of one.
That's nice. You can almost predict a win.
Except for this track.
No.
Now there you see David Hobbs performing refueling operation. I think. No, you see John Watson getting out of the car is what that is.
Yeah. John is getting out. Looking at it. Well, yeah, I'd like to buy one of these. All the drivers.
Tires, John, the way your luck has been going. While we have a moment here, we mentioned it's been a very successful season for us here at ESPN, telecasting Camel GT races. We'd like to thank John Bishop, the president of IMSA, Mark Rafoff, the chief steward, and all of the staff, the International Motorsports Association. Dick Vanderfiend, their press director, has been especially helpful to us. We look forward to being with you again next year, guys. What a way to wind it out. Bob Tullius and the Jaguar team. 18 months without a victory. It goes all the way back to April of 1984 at a racetrack near my home, Road Atlanta in Braselton, Georgia. And they went 1-2 in that event.
They did. And it really has been a most unusual drought. The Group 44 organization has been spectacularly successful for, 20-odd years now. They've just been one of the real dominant forces in American racing, whether they go in the SEC areas, Trans Am, or even the Pacific category. They always do well. And their cars always look so good, too. Lanky and Bell do a great job.
Lanky Fouché, great name for a crew chief.
Well, you tell him it was Brady Cooper Walker because he's such a big fella. You see the size of his head? Probably play for the Raiders.
Bob Tullius, who's got a record in more than one series. He is the last gentleman to collect 2 titles in Trans Am categories in SCCA competition. That record may be broken by Wally Dallenbach, who is also still on the racetrack in the Corvette. But there is your leader, Bob Tullius, and we'll be back with the conclusion of our race after these messages.
You take on a road.
You think BMW has advanced technology? Listen to this.
Your door is open.
For about $22,000, you can own a BMW 325. Or the hollow feeling of having settled for less.
We're back live at Daytona, and there you see the BMW number 19 with John Watson aboard. They have managed to refuel that car, although it is probably the longest refueling stop in IMSA history. Hobbs hand-carried a fuel tank out there, and the car that was once first is now out of the top 10. Gary Lee has a couple of guests down on pit road.
Well, I don't know. Perhaps we have the making for a good vocal group here. At least one guy, John Oates from Hall & Oates, can sing. I don't know about Rob Dyson. I know I can't. First of all, Rob, this is a great day for your team. You really need the victory. It's been a very, very trying year. You've crashed a lot of equipment.
Yeah, it has been tough. In fact, even this weekend has been tough. I kind of backed the car into a sandbank earlier on Friday. We didn't run yesterday, so we had to start 16th. Fortunately, the race was long enough that we were able to catch up, and Price is doing a super job.
It's an important ride for Price for two reasons. He can win the Porsche Cup today, clinch that, also overhaul Derek Bell for second in the GT standings.
That's right. We're all keeping our fingers crossed. Price had a lead going into the Porsche Cup for this race. That obviously, it'll be a boost for that. But the big thing that we had coming down to Daytona this race was to do well enough so Price could move second into the overall IMSA standings.
Well, right before we head off to Victory Lane and talk to the winner, let's talk to this guy right here, John Oates from Hall & Oates. I know for a fact you also drive race cars.
Well, I have been in the past. Not this year, though. I'm taking a little break from it. Concentrate on making some money for a change.
And then after you make the money, is it back to racing again?
Well, I'm going to be involved in racing for a long time because I've always loved it. I don't know in what capacity.
We always enjoy seeing you at the racetrack. Enjoy your visit to Florida.
Thank you very much.
All right, we're going to head off to Victory Lane and send it back up to the tower.
Well, thank you very much, Gary. 8 minutes remain. 8 minutes as Bob Tullius makes his way around the Daytona International Speedway road course. There you see the actual time left. A great, great victory in store, if we can knock wood and say that, after watching so many lead changes today, so many heartbreaking moments for these teams. 92 laps are in the books. Your leader, the Jaguar, number 44, Price Cobb, is in second position. The number 14 car of Derek Bell, by the way, is currently shown sixth. 68 Porsche, Darren Brassfield and John Morton, the 5 car of James Weaver and Bob Aiken, and the 0 machine of Barilla and Wallach and Winter.
Well, Bob looks like he's driving very conservatively at this point. He's just trying to be very precise and not put the car into any long slides or hit any curbs. He wants to be as neat as he possibly can. Don't let anything happen. If something can happen, it will. Bob doesn't want that to right now.
For a half a minute lead for the 44 Jaguars, he overtakes another GTO machine.
It's really been an impressive day for this particular car, too. You'd think that without that off-course excursion that Bob had, they would have a really impressive lead at this point.
So as Bob Tullius makes his way around, we'll update the GTO situation. Scott Pruitt still out front. The one lap lead over the 99 Toyota of Chris Cord and the 76 Chevy Camaro of Jack Baldwin. So it looks like a big day for Ford in GTO. Now we're getting where the Corvette, number 52 Corvette, there you see it, is slowing down. Sarah Vandermeer, the Corvette that sat on the pole and led this race for much of the early going.
Watching exit. No, definitely. No, there's a GTP light car that's passing, so he does have a problem.
That was the 73 car. That's the leader in the Camel Light class. Howard Cass and Steve Phillips.
Their little Chevy engine just passed the big Chevy engine.
The difference being turbocharging, among other things. Now here we go. Now Jack Baldwin and Bruce Jenner are into it. Now that will put Baldwin, I believe, back into fourth position on the racetrack. That will seal Chevy's fate in the manufacturer's standing.
I think Jack has got a problem out there with something. Look at this. The car just won't turn. There's something wrong with that car. The left-hand corner, the car was pushing to the outside. It didn't want to stay tucked in nice and neat. Let's watch him go through this and just see what happens here.
See the nose of the car? Looks like there's been some damage to the front left. You see the nose of the car dipping down noticeably. It's not very streamlined at all. He's taking a shot in the snoot.
Yeah, the car is not turning well around that corner either, so it's possibly a deflated front tire. Affecting it both ways. See how gently he's going through that corner. Watch here.
With his hands full.
Yeah. Front wheels are just sliding right across the track. That thing is not biting well at all.
So the GT Wars appear to be headed in forward direction. We'll be back for the conclusion of the race after this short message. We're live at Daytona. Stay with us for the end. Gary Lee is on pit road, and there you see the time remaining for the Jaguar team to break one of the longest droughts in the fabled Jaguar racing history.
You know, it's really very, very fitting that Jaguar might just, looks like they're going to end up winning it, but it looks like it's such a fitting finish to this season, because it started out with so many different winners and so many different races. Finally, Holder Racing got everything together and won. Now we're going to get another different winner. Tremendously competitive season. Again, IMSA has to be congratulated for just getting a very, very good formula, keeping so many cars in there.
By the way, the BMW team that's been so jinxed today has gotten their 18 car back on its feet, so they have both machines back on the racetrack. 19 car and the 18 car both presently out of the top five. But there is your leader, Bob Tullius, making his way down behind the GTO leader, Scott Pruitt. So while Jaguar will break a long victory drought, it appears, here at Daytona, Scott Pruitt, one of the fine young race drivers in America, will chalk up his first major series driving championship in the IMSA GTO division. How many years Bob Tullius has led this team, always holding up the Jaguar banner in the face of the arrival and then the rise of turbocharging.
Well, he's really been a fighter against turbochargers, and I think he was the strongest levy in force last year for this weight penalty that was put on the Porsches this year. And Bob had a very arguable point that if everything else was equal when it came right down to the last lap, if you had that variable boost gauge inside the car, you crank it up, you get your 200 horsepower more, and all of a sudden it's not an equal race anymore.
Now, Scott Pruitt coming up behind Bob Tullius should be able to run fairly close on the straightaways with that Jaguar. See that Bob has opened up a gap, so Scott obviously has been told to cool it, take it easy, a minute and a half to go. Now he has to cross the finish line with 3 hours totally complete, so it looks as though
this should be their last lap.
There will be one lap to go, it would seem. It's going to be a happy Group 44 Jaguar pits tonight.
We're going to be calling all the local chiropractors when Lanky gives bear hugs to the rest of the crew.
Very fitting that Bob Tullius should be behind the wheel. 49 years old, he's got a birthday coming up December 7th from Winchester, Virginia. It's been a long, hard fight for his Jaguar team, and today they will be rewarded. Speaking of birthdays, I don't normally do this, but I'd like to wish a happy birthday to my father back home. Sorry I can't be there, Dad, but this has been fun. Half a minute to go, the three-hour mark will pass, and Bob Tullius will make his way around the final lap here at Daytona International Speedway. A quick dip onto pit road while we watch Tullius. The 16 Porsche of Price Cobb has ducked into there. Maybe a fuel problem here. He's in for a quick splash. Presently shown second on the racetrack. They've got to make this one quick. The 68 Porsche, the BFG car, coming up behind. Understand the BMW machine. There it is, the 18 car. That's Davy Jones hopping out. Has evidently suffered another problem. He is parked. He is out of harm's way on the pit apron, but we saw Davy Jones hop out of that car. Well, we said they had it going. Obviously, they don't. We are being told now that he hit the wall. It was out of our view at the far end of the racetrack. Flashers are on the tow trucks in that area, so in fact, they've even got an ambulance headed in that direction. Bob Tullius one more time on the big NASCAR stock car banking here at Daytona.
Last time around this corner, the checkered flag is out.
And down he comes, Bob Tullius, Winchester, Virginia.
There we go. Congratulations,
the checkered
Bob.
Checkered flag for Bob Tullius, his co-driver Chip Robinson. It wasn't easy and it wasn't elegant, but he got it done. And here comes the 1986 GTO champion at IMSA Campbell GT Racing, Scott Pruitt out of Roseville, California. Kind of ironic that one of the oldest drivers on the series and one of the youngest and most promising both take victories today. And that is a very, very happy Scott Pruitt. He had a couple of crashes, a couple of cars go out from under him for mechanical reasons this year. In fact, he carried Bruce Jenner's car to a couple of victories this year, which helped tighten up that points race.
We're going to be able to get a new picture of Bob Tullius here because his smile is going to be so wide when he gets into victory lane.
Exactly what I was thinking. He's not that solemn expression now.
I think he'll be cracking the helmet right now.
And with his victory, Scott Pruitt in GTO, it's our understanding, has wrapped up the GTO manufacturer's title for Ford. We'll double-check that. Jack Baldwin, Chevy Camaro. Baldwin, that is, has pulled onto pit road. Here is your Camel Lights winner. That's Howard Katz and Steve Phillips, along with the second place GTP car of Price Cobb, which will probably net for him the Porsche Cup in North America. Great racing, great victories today for a lot of deserving drivers.
Really good job for them, and really great for Chevrolet. They have this brand new engine for GTP lights. Here's some congratulations from the track workers.
You see the track workers? See that green and white hat on that track worker? You bet he was pulling for the Jaguars all the way.
That's a popular car. Very popular team as well.
Just like Bob Tullius, to go over and pick out a guy that he's probably been racing and suffering in front of for years and give him a personal thank you. Great sportsmanship here on the Campbell GT season. There is the trophy that will go to the very deserving Jaguar team. As Bob Tullius makes his way around, Gary Lee is down in victory lane, and we will go to Gary to meet the winners of today's race in just a few moments. As you watch Bob Tullius making his way around, a victory lap that's been a long time coming.
When you take on the track, you're taking your tires to the limit. BM Goodrich started it all, testing street ratings in races like this and like this. The more we race, the more we prove what a tire can do. On cars like this and like this. BF Goodrich TA Ratings, built for you to take on the road.
In the beginning of recorded history, man had an idea called a caravan. Slow and plodding, right first time. Some years later, man had a better idea. Dodge Caravan. Efficient, versatile, and perfect for its time. With front-wheel drive and a 550 protection plan, this is why Dodge Caravan has no equal in the civilized world. Dodge, setting new standards of performance.
Get on the fast track.
Happy scene in victory lane as Chip Robinson congratulates his car owner, Bob Tullius, on a job well done.
You know, a real interesting point, too, that after all our talk of Chip Robinson's brilliance, today is his first Campbell GT victory. So congratulations are very, very big to Chip.
That last one at Road Atlanta came at the hands of Bob Tullius and Brian Redman, and this one is for Tullius and Robinson. Let's go down to Gary Lee.
This was a very important win for you, your first win this season. You have lots of them, but probably not one more important than this one here.
Well, you're right, in more respects than you'll ever know, my friend. I really don't know how to say this altogether, but this may be the very last time I get an opportunity to stand in this circle. It has been 26 years.
We talked to you earlier. We can see the emotion now swell up in the eyes, but we talked to you earlier, and you told us, as he is being comforted and congratulated by his co-driver, Chip Robinson, that there would be one car you would be involved next year. Are you saying now that you may not be driving next season?
Well, I'll drive when necessary, but that may not be with good guys like him around and other fellows that are capable of going a little bit faster than I am in these declining years. It's been a long time. It's the first time I've ever thought about not driving, but I've got to think about it sometime.
Did those thoughts occur to you in the last two or three laps out there?
It has occurred to me just trying to make a decision whether to start the race, because as a starter, you finish it the way the time falls. And I wanted a chance to finish it if we could win, and under the circumstances, I'm really happy I did.
It wasn't a real easy day for you two rascals out here. You both had your trouble. Now, we talked to Chip about his earlier. What happened when you went out into the pit stop?
Well, the throttle was sticking, and I didn't realize it, and I learned to cope with it shortly, but it bit me a couple of times before I realized what was happening. And once I knew what was happening, it was fine.
Chip, I know he has high praise for you as a young driver, but we talked over the weekend. This is your first win, but this guy right here has been like a father figure for you with the Jag program.
I'll tell you, there was nobody that I would have rather had in the car with me when we got into the push of the weekend win than Bob Tullius. He's been great for me, and it's just fantastic for Jaguar, for him, and the whole team. It's great.
I know a couple of years ago when we were talking about your career in Super V's, you had not thought about IMSA GTP. Now you say you're glad you're here and you're glad you're with Bob Tullius.
That's exactly right. I couldn't have come with a better team. They've been fantastic. And this is the start. We're going to win some more.
A full kaleidoscope of emotions here, from tears of joy and sadness. Our congratulations to Bob Tullius and Chip Robinson, Group 44 in Victory Lane, the first time this season.
Well, I don't know how much more you can add to an interview like that. Congratulations indeed to Bob Tullius and Chip Robinson. One career just beginning to blossom, and one career that may finally be closing up. Great, great victory for Jaguar. Bill, I know you've driven for this team, and so this has to be kind of emotional for you, too.
Yeah, it's 4 years of that team, and it has special meaning for me, too.
Okay, we want to get a hold of Scott Pruitt, our GTO winner. We'll be back to talk with him right after these messages. Well, the lion's share of a record $257,000 purse goes to the Jaguar team, Bob Tullius and Chip Robinson, but it can't buy the kind of victory that Bob Tullius has won today. Terrific race for Jaguar, and a terrific race for Scott Pruitt, who has won the GTO championship, and he's standing by now with Gary Lee.
GTO championship, we talked to him about the Ford Manufacturers Championship, and that brought a real smile to a youngster's face.
That's right. You know, it's been back and forth between Chevrolet and Ford, and you know, we were wanting to come in here and do well, and above all, I was thinking about winning the Drivers Championship, and it's awful nice to win a race, and it's even better to win a championship.
But let's underscore the fact that you had to qualify your car and the car of your closest competitor for the championship, your teammate's car.
Well, that's no problem. You know, we've been working back and forth the whole season, and he's done a hell of a job. He's come a long way. He ran a fabulous race today.
Here he is right now. You got some words for the champion and your teammate over here?
Way to go, Scott. I've known Scott for 4 years. Met him many years ago at the Long Beach Grand Prix. I worked with him with Ford and introduced him to Lee Morris and everybody at Ford to get him the ride, and he's just been absolutely great. And I promoted the heck out of the kid, and I hope he's out of the series now.
All right, there you have it from Bruce Jenner, second in the standings, and there's your champion, Scott Pruitt. Back to you, Bob.
Okay, thank you very much, Gary Lee, and we should probably point out as well that Scott Pruitt's victory wins the manufacturer's title for Ford by mere 4 points over Chevrolet. Great race, great action, great competition. We'll be back to conclude and say our goodbyes from Daytona after this. This Camel GT season, we hope you've enjoyed it. Today's live coverage of the 3 hours of Daytona has been brought to you by BF Goodrich TA Radials, built for you to take on the road. By Dodge, a performance revolution, an American revolution. By BMW, the ultimate driving machine. To arrange a thorough test drive, simply phone your nearest BMW dealer. Our congratulations to all of our winners today, Bob Tullius and Chip Robinson, Scott Pruitt, Howard Katz and Steve Phillips, and the Camel Lights class. It's been a great, great race. On behalf of Bill Adam working with me in the commentary booth, thanks, Bill, for a great year.
My
Gary
pleasure.
Lee down in pit road. All of us here at ESPN. We hope you've enjoyed.
I'm Karen Robinson.